Hi guys, Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive. Thanks for joining me. It's Monday evening. We're here to talk about guitar, the thing we do every Monday evening. And speaking of guitars, the red guitar is back. Hey, look at this. We haven't had this guitar in some time. For those of you that aren't familiar, this is my favorite guitar. This is my number one. I don't know why I haven't brought it out on live streams recently, but here it is. So hey, if you guys are into the red guitar, I'm into the red guitar, we'd love to know. So let's get straight in with some housekeeping. First of all, it is really great to have you on board. Thanks for joining us. If you're a first time viewer, welcome. We stream on this YouTube channel or this Facebook page or this Twitch channel, I guess. Wherever you're finding us, 8 p.m. UK time, 3 p.m. EST, 12 noon PST every Monday. We have free guitar lessons for you because we love you guys and we want to give back to our little community that's building up here. We have just the best group of guitar players who are tuning in week on week and it is just growing. So if you're just joining us for the first time, it's great to have you. If you are an existing friend, hey, it's great to have you back. Let's check in with the stream before we get into the meat of today's lesson, which is, of course, tension, managing tension. Essentially, how much tension should you have in your playing? Is tension necessary? When is too much tension a bad thing? When is a bit of tension a good thing? When is too little tension a bad thing? We will get onto all of these things in a moment. But first of all, let's just remind you guys, if you are getting some value out of these streams and you would like to support us, a few ways you can do it. The first and easiest way is by giving us a thumbs up or a like and dropping us a comment on whatever platform you're watching this stream on. Comments really do help. Thumbs ups really do help. Shares help immensely. So if you'd like to share this with your guitar playing friends, hey, it would be an honor if you would. That'd be great. It would really help us out. Also, a way you can help us out is you can check out GI Plus. Links in the description. It's up here in the top corner. See this logo just kind of kicking around here. It's going to be there all evening. And now that you've seen it, you're never going to be able to unsee it. Look, my hand goes behind it and everything. GI Plus is our exclusive lesson platform where you can check out lessons that will support all of this content and go into much greater detail than we can in the context of a 1 hour live stream, but that is not going to stop me trying. So we'll get into the tension thing in a moment. Before we do, let's just check in with the stream. If you haven't done so already, let me know where you guys are tuning in from, what you've been up to this week, what has been on your guitar playing mind. I'd like to know what's been bugging you, what you've been practicing, if you had any breakthroughs this week, any cool songs you've learned, cool licks. I would love to know. So let's check in with the stream. Let's see how everyone's getting on. Mark McNish was first through the door a whole hour before we kicked off. Mark, good on you. Good to have you. A returning guest of the stream. Mark says, hi, gents. Mark, it's great to have you. Marcin is in the house. Marcin is an OG member of our little stream community. Marcin, it's great to have you. We have some really cool observations from Obscure Guitar by Skip Newman. You guys have challenged me to pronounce these usernames week on week on week, but I will try my best. Tension and holding my breath when working on speeding something up or just doing a solo. Ooh, interesting. We're going to come back to that. Remind me of that if I forget. Cowcat, bringer of the hilarity, says, hi, just thinking how King Diamond would sing Monday Tension and Andy LaRock playing acoustic to it. Nuts. Hey, it's like they knew we were coming, wasn't it? Sacred Godslayer is in the house, says, hi, guys. It's great to have you on board. Ken Singleton says, hello. Ken, it's great to have you. Thanks for joining us. PJ says, good evening, Nick and everyone. PJ, it's great to see you. My friend Scott is tuning in. Evening, dude. You good, Scott? I'm great. Those videos you sent me, absolutely tremendous, by the way. Really, really great. I'm going to get around to formulating a full response for you at some point, but really, really chuffed with, first of all, the song choices. Really cool songs. Scott's been sending me some videos of his guitar playing. I would love to see your guitar playing too, by the way. So if you want to send me a video, hey, please do. Maybe we'll feature it on the stream if you guys are okay with it. I'll ask Scott about that behind the scenes a little bit later on. Joe Johnson says, evening, Shred Maestro Nick. Shred Mistro Nick. Shred Miso. Miso Soup. It's a description of my guitar playing. Blue Sumlin, another OG stream friend. It's great to have you. I'm going to call you Blues. Why not? Or shall I call you Sumlin? Pete C is tuning in around the corner from my house. Pete, if you're going to be at the Northeast Guitar Show this week, or anybody who's based in the Northeast, we're going to be playing in the performance tent at 12:15, just after lunch, which is a good time to play, I gather, because I will have eaten, which is nice. Always keeps me happy. Who else do we have? Larry Warren is tuning in. Larry Warren says, greetings from the west coast of Canada. Time change messed me up, but I got it. Oh, of course. Time zones are the enemy, man. We're going to be going to British summertime soon. I'll have to remember to update all the emails that you guys get. If you're not signed up, by the way, you can sign up to our mailing list and we'll give you notifications about when we're going live, so you never have to miss a stream. Frank says, good evening all. Is this a men-only stream? It is absolutely not a men-only stream by design. We at Guitar Interactive are champions of women in music, but unfortunately it's still a male-dominated space is the guitar. We need the other 50% of the population playing guitar. It's one of those things. If the instrument is going to survive, then it needs to be open to all. So, hey, female guitar players, if you are out there, we'd love to hear from you. So, let's keep rocking on with these comments. Steve McDee says, hi, all. Steve McDee, it's great to have you. What else? We got some comments about daylight saving time. Ryan Just says, thumb placement. What is proper thumb placement? Some say never place your thumb over the guitar neck unless doing a bend. We have gone into this in detail, my man, Ryan, but we're going to get onto it in a moment. Incidentally, I have a whole lesson about thumb placement on my course, Technique Hot Fixes. A link is available in the description. Check out the bit where it says, check out Nick's latest course. That'll take you to Technique Hot Fixes. You can buy it, but it's not really worth you buying it because, to be honest, the membership for an annual membership for GI Plus is so crazy cheap that you might as well just sign up or even just sign up for the monthly membership, see if you like it. But hey, if you like to buy things, then it's there for you too. Whole lesson on that and like nine other things too. But I will answer that question today, even still. Blue Sumlin says, tension in tense or string tensions? Ooh, that is an interesting point. Who else do we have? Bilious Fat Bob says, hi and hello, Nick, and checkered flag. Hey, we made it. Who else do we have? I'm going to do just a couple more. Let's play guitar. Says, Nick, I love your playing and feel. Man, that's really kind of you. Thank you so much. Very, very kind indeed. Let's see. Andy Keeley says, I don't think you'd appreciate a video of me playing my air guitar. However, I'm awesome at it. This I do not doubt, my man. This is a friend of mine. We go way, way, way back. Last question. Daughtry Fan 497 Trowbridge. Hi, I'm Diesel from Connecticut. Wow, fantastic. That is a great name. If your name is Diesel, power to you. Like, I'm hoping it's like Big Daddy Cool Diesel because I'm a mark. For those of you who know, you know. So anyway, let's get into the meat of today's lesson, which is tension. And we are going to define our terms because, as Blue Sumlin has rightly pointed out, tension in the sense of tense or in the sense of string tension. Now, this is interesting because when I started thinking about this stream, and I started planning for it, I thought, hey, you know, we're going to talk about tension in the hands, but it just like rapidly expanded from there. There's so much stuff to talk about, so we'll get into that. I'm referring to tension as in being tense in your playing. Now, let's talk initially about different kinds of tension. There is what I might call intentional tension. Wow, this is going to be a hard thing to say. When I wrote it down, it made much more sense. So, intentional tension, i.e. tension that you are doing deliberately, and then unintentional tension or accidental tension, I guess, involuntary tension, which is where you're playing and then for whatever reason, circumstances cause you to be more tense than you might otherwise be. Have you all heard the term red light fever? For example, when the red light goes on, your playing just goes to the proverbial. We've all done this, right? If you all, let me know in the comments if you have. If you've done this before, where you've been playing away, maybe you've hit the record button because you have a cool idea and suddenly you're all thumbs and the guitar just doesn't work anymore. I get it all the time. I have to overcome this pretty much every time I sit down in front of a camera to talk to you guys, but luckily I know I'm among friends, so I don't have to worry too much. You guys are very sympathetic of my gaffes, and you know my feelings on you know, on mistakes, for example. You know that I like to leave mistakes in my videos. I don't like to fix stuff too much because guitar players make mistakes, and I don't feel like it's a good thing for the guitar community at large to manicure your playing too much. I think it sets kind of a false standard that's very difficult to live up to. Anyway, we're not here to talk about that. So let's crack on. So tension, unintentional tension, intentional tension. Let's start by talking about the intentional side of it, i.e. how much tension are you using to facilitate your playing technique on a perfect day when you are completely relaxed and, you know, everything's golden. You've maybe had a lovely Sunday dinner if you're in the UK and it's nice and relaxed. It's a warm evening. Maybe not yet, it's not, but it's a warm evening and you're playing away and everything's great and you're using X amount of tension. Well, there are schools of thought for this. So the first school of thought is that you should use as little tension as possible when you're playing your guitar. Let's go to the close-up camera. I'm going to show you what that looks like. So close-up camera, let's go to a clean sound because why not? You guys still hear that? Okay, let me know if that's still of a reasonable volume for you. So our minimal tension playing approach would imply that any tension beyond the absolute least tension that you can use to play the guitar is bad and is unnecessary. I'm not 100% certain that this is true for a variety of reasons that we'll get into in a moment, but let's take a look at what that might look like. So I'm going to play a scale for you guys, and if you want to play along, it's going to be real simple. We're going to start on fret number 3 on the low E string. I'm going to play 3-5-7, 3-5-7, and then 4-5-7, and then I'll come back down. Just realized how dead these strings are, so maybe I'll go to a split coil, see if that cleans it up a little bit. Nope, absolutely not, never mind. So I'm gonna play with as little tension as I possibly can, and then I'm gonna start to apply a little bit more tension progressively as we go. I want you to pay attention to the sound, and I want you to tell me what you think you're hearing in the comments. So let's try. We're gonna start with minimal tension. Even missed the note, I was that relaxed. So I'm hearing two things there, two things, apart from the fact that I need to change my strings because they've gone a little bit off. I am hearing that as we start to increase our tension, or I start to increase my tension, the playing gets louder, the dynamic changes just a little bit, but also things start to maybe get a little bit clunky. Now, I am deliberately changing tension in both hands at once here. I'm deliberately gripping harder with this hand and playing just as hard with this hand. But let's try a different experiment. Let's try just increasing the amount of tension in the left hand. So I'm gonna keep the pick and hand the same. This is very difficult to do. I want to know if you guys can do this. So start off by playing super, super lightly, like this. And then with your left hand, start to grip a little harder. You can see the difficulty start to creep in. Try and keep the right hand exactly the same if you can. Oh, that's not easy. That's very, very hard to do. Let's do the opposite. Let's keep the left hand nice and relaxed, and let's increase and decrease the amount of tension in the right hand. Pay attention to how hard I'm gripping the pick for this. So here we go. Interesting. Now, what you might have noticed with this is you might have noticed that the left hand tension didn't seem to have a profound effect on the tone at all. It seemed to sound exactly the same, basically, just felt a little less convenient. However, when we started to increase and decrease our right hand tension, that's when things started to change. We started to get a different tonal result. Now you might just say, well, you're just picking harder. Well, yeah, I am. How do you think we pick harder? We pick harder by being a little more, using a little more energy on the string. So we need to define some terms on that. So let's get into the difference between tension and dynamics, or the similarities between tension and dynamics. Now, as far as tension goes, if you play with as little tension as is humanly possible, you are somewhat limited in your dynamic range, because to play genuinely loud requires a certain degree of tension, let's say, a certain degree of force or a certain degree of energy going into the strings. And I'm not going to make a distinction here. I'm not going to make a distinction between tension and energy, because it's kind of the same thing. When you put force into the string pushes back. So let me show you what I'm talking about. If I play very, very lightly with a real light grip, doesn't matter how hard I lay into this with my right hand, because this hand is super relaxed, I can't get suitably convincingly loud note out of this pick. If I hold the pick real tight, even comparatively quite relaxed with this hand, I can get a really loud note. So we've discussed this before. We've discussed the idea that pick grip influences dynamics. If you want to check out some previous streams on this, you can do so on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel, which is probably why you're watching this based on our analytics. But if you're watching it somewhere else, you can check it out on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. You can watch all the streams that we have ever done. They're all up there. There's going to be a big playlist of them where you can find them. And one thing we talked about was dynamics, specifically in our Is Tone in the Fingers kind of series. But anyway, for me to get this dynamic range, I have to be able to play with a grip that is harder than my maximally relaxed tension. And by maximally relaxed, what I mean is as light as I can possibly play. So I need to be able to play with some degree of tension. However, to exploit my dynamic range, what I also need to be able to do is I also need to be able to play with little tension, with less tension, because if I'm gripping as hard as I possibly can, even if I play with comparatively light touch in this hand, it's really difficult to get a convincingly quiet note like this one. So that is a little something on right hand tension. Now, what I mean by this is to exploit your dynamic range, we need to be able to play with both quite an amount of tension and not too much tension. Now that's dynamics, right? Dynamics do somewhat come from pick grip, but there's more to it than that. We've got some comments already. I'm just gonna draw your attention to this. Let's see here. Blue Sumlin says, just feels uncomfortable, the increase of right hand. Now that is interesting, that's fascinating. With some more comments, let's just see this one here. When I pick hard on my left hand, tension increases. Any ideas to solve this? Well, that is the $1 million question. And we are gonna answer that question. We absolutely are, because I have some great solutions for that. I'm gonna tell you guys about that a little bit later on, because don't wanna put the cart before the horse, so to speak. So if you are getting some use out of this, by the way, guys, if you just tuned in and you're enjoying this discussion on tension, consider giving us a like, give us a thumbs up on whatever platform you're watching. Don't forget to subscribe, sign up for notifications as well, so we can let you know when we're streaming. And if you wanna, you can sign up for our mailing list too. We'll let you know when we're going live. By the way, it's every Monday, 8 p.m. UK time, 3 p.m. EST, 12 noon PST. Anyway, on with the show. So that's dynamics. But what about things like playing cleanly and playing accurately and all that sort of stuff? Well, this is somewhat dependent on having a fairly relaxed approach to your left hand. Now, we discussed in our previous example how the left hand, increasing tension in the left hand like this. Jeez, that really hurts. It's not doing him any harm, by the way. I should point out that's not doing you any damage if you feel like that's what's going on. We'll get onto that. It's another story for another day. It doesn't really have too much of an effect on the tone when I'm picking, but what about when I'm playing with legato? So let's start with hammer-ons, right? So I'm going to begin with playing my hammer-ons with a maximally relaxed sound. If you want to play along, let's do that scale again. So that sounds pretty loud, and I'm not really playing particularly aggressively. I'm having a very light, almost like a dancer's touch. Tom Quayle talks about this, where it's like you're playing as like a dancer, like a ballet dancer, just like playing with strength, but not playing with tension, so to speak. If I start to tense up a little bit in my left hand and I start to grip a little harder, things change. So if I go like this, very, very light touch, and then I start to grip real hard, it doesn't really increase the volume. This is interesting. We don't actually get any more volume out of our hammer-ons by being tight. It doesn't really work that way. We'll get onto what does cause the volume in hammer-ons in a bit. It doesn't really increase the amount of sound I'm getting, which is, and let me know if this is you, by the way, And even if you don't do it on purpose, let me know if this is something that you do. That's generally what happens when we tense up when we're playing. We're trying to get more sound out of the guitar. It's in an effort to try harder. Something maybe doesn't go right, and we thought, I must try harder. We'll get onto that when we discuss involuntary or unintentional tension creeping into your guitar playing. That's something that happens. Let me know if that's you. It's red light fever as well. It's kind of one of those things that we'll talk about. But it doesn't actually give us any more volume with the left hand. Slightly counterintuitive, because a harder grip does give us more volume with the right hand, but with the left hand, not so much. Now, that's hammer-ons. What about pull-offs? So we'll do some pull-offs with a brush touch. We've talked about this here. Now, our brush touch is where, instead of physically flicking the string, what we do is we use the callus on the hand to brush the string, almost like doing this. It's a brushing kind of touch rather than plucking kind of touch. Now, plucking with a pull-off does actually give you a little more volume, using a lot of tension. Big plucky pull-offs can give you a cool snap. I would argue that's more of a special effect than a general way to play, although Guthrie Govan does talk about this. Guthrie talks about the idea of pull-offs being as aggressive as you can get them. There's some disagreement with this, because Guthrie, obviously, world-class legato player, but then you also have world-class legato players like Tom Quayle and like Marshall Harrison and these guys who don't advocate for this. They advocate the opposite. They advocate, you know, playing with a brush. So I guess it's preference to an extent. But anyway, this brush touch, if we play real light. Then I start to get a little bit more aggressive with my grip. Does start to give me a little more volume on the pull-offs. Now, this is interesting because this is something we can use for dynamic effect. Let me show you what I'm talking about. I'm going to go back to a backing track, and I'm going to find one that is maybe shred appropriate. Let's do the 5-4 Seattle groove. I apologize if my amp makes some funny noises, by the way. It starts screaming a little bit. But like this. So it started going woo. I'm going to take it in for repair soon. My quad cortex is down at the rehearsal room as well. Otherwise, I just plug that in. Really been into that lately. Oh my goodness, like what a game changer. So anyway, let's run with this. So this is in E minor. It's a 5-4 grunge type thing. Let's go to the course of cam. If I... play with as light of a touch as I can. I'm going to do my hammer-ons first with some distortion. Now, if my touch is light with the pull-offs, they start to blend with the hammer-ons, and I get this real kind of smooth sound, which is quite nice. Ends up with this sort of thing. Quite hard not to play, because I tend to do this as an effect. Let's try that again. Now let's try doing it with some plucks. So if I pluck really hard at the top end of some of these lines, don't worry if you can't follow this stuff, by the way, you're not really supposed to. If I do some plucks at the top end of the lines, I can make certain notes pop out and get kind of this dynamic kind of sound, which I think is quite cool for a rock sort of vibe, I guess, so maybe this sort of thing. What's interesting with this is, I don't even know if that's coming across to you guys, but what I'm hearing is when I start to get a little more tense with my pull-offs, I can get this meowing sound that Alan Holdsworth hated, but I think is pretty cool for a rock thing. Again, this is stylistic as much as anything else, but it does come with a trade-off. It does come with a trade-off, because too much tension with this hand, let's say, it somewhat immobilizes the fingers. If you use too much, it starts to kind of stop you from executing the things you want to execute. So let's go back to the clean sound. We're going to do a little game. What I want you guys to do is grab your guitars if you haven't done so already. I want you to stick all four fingers down on the A string, let's say. It doesn't really matter which string, but we'll do the A string together. And what I want you to do is I want you to put them on frets 5, 6, 7, and 8. Doesn't really matter, as long as they're all each on a fret. And with, like, really, really, really light, easy fingers, what I want you to do is just take your first finger, move it to the D string, and then back again. Now move it to the E string, and then back again. Let's do that with the second finger. Same deal. E string, back again. Easy. Third finger, that's a little weird, but it still works. It's fine. And let's do the fourth finger. Boop. And then again, back up here. Nice and easy. So with light fingers, that's a piece of cake, right? Let's grip for all we're worth. Let's absolutely slam our fingers into the into the fretboard. Now let's try the same experiment. Keeping your fingers real tight. Finger one kind of works. Finger two suddenly feels painful in the palm of my hand. Finger three is almost impossible. Finger four, it's going in between the strings. It's just not very accurate. This is the trade-off when we start to employ too much left hand tension. You can get a cool sound on pull-offs. Doesn't make a difference on pick notes, and it doesn't make a difference on hammer-ons. But it does come at the expense of your fingers not really responding. Now, if you've ever experienced this, if you've ever had this thing, by the way, you ever had this thing where you're playing and your finger just won't go for whatever reason. Now, there's two things that can cause this. If you sort of, you have this thing where your finger just won't respond, you go finger, go to fret number 5. And it's just like, nah, I'm not going. I'm staying here. And you go, but why? Why are you doing this? Now, if it's something that you've never asked your fingers to do ever before, it could be just that it's unfamiliar. And that's not really what we're talking about here. If, however, by contrast, you find that, you know, when you reach for a certain note, your finger just won't go there. It goes there really slowly, or it misses. It could be that you have too much fretting tension going on in your technique. That could be the cause of that. Now, let's get into the performance side of it a little bit, because we've talked about some dynamics, and we've talked about how right-hand dynamics are governed to an extent by tension. We've talked about how left-hand dynamics aren't until you start doing pull-offs, in which case you can use very aggressive pluck-style pull-offs to get some kind of like dynamic range into your legato playing. But let's talk about why these things start to come in. So that's kind of intentional stuff. There are some situations where you may find yourself being tense for no good reason. You're playing away and you go, why am I so tense? What's going on? A lot of times it comes from the desire to impress. It comes from the desire to put your best foot forward, or the desire not to embarrass yourself. Let's say somebody walks in on you practicing and you go, oh my God, I better sound my best. This person is listening to me practice my A minor pentatonic scale. I better sound my best. It doesn't have to be external either. It can be internal. So it can come from playing something and having it not go quite right. So you go like this. And it starts to clunk up a little bit at the bottom, and you go, all right, okay, I didn't play that right. I'd better try harder. I want you to be careful with that that instinct, because that instinct is not always the way. Try harder, as far as we're concerned, generally involves just adding more. And when we say more, we mean play harder, grip harder, attack the guitar more. Rarely is this the answer. It is the answer if you're playing sounding a little wimpy and you don't have enough, like, kind of attack in your right hand. Yeah, hit a little bit harder. But if what's happening is it's not being as accurate as you want, or maybe your fingers aren't quite going where you want them to go, trying harder is very rarely the answer. And trying harder is very rarely the answer even if it comes to, let's say, you fret a note and it doesn't come out. You know, you play here and it goes clunk, 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 clunk. That is rarely a case of not trying hard enough. Unless you're an absolute beginner who doesn't have any hand strength built up. For most of us, we are plenty strong enough to fret a note. If you can fret a note, you can fret a note. So you know what I mean? Like if you're playing away and you go, man, this note just won't come out. That note there won't come out. It is very, very rarely because you're not pressing hard enough. It's usually because you're not using the right part of the finger, or you're too tense and the finger can't get into position, or maybe there's a synchronization issue between left and right hand. Now, this comes from, ironically, trying too hard. There's a book that I think you guys should all read, and every musician should read. It's called The Inner Game of Tennis by W. Timothy Galway. There isn't Inner Game of Music, it's not as good. Inner Game of Tennis is the one. Now, the best part about this is you only really need the first four chapters, but what it fundamentally comes down to is the desire to try and govern our playing, to try and like micromanage your technique. It comes from, it kind of comes from a place of ego, and it's generally a fool's errand because your body doesn't work that way. Your body's incredibly sophisticated at figuring stuff out. Now, what I want you to do, let's do an experiment here real quick. Let's grab your guitar. What I want you to do is I want you to play me an A minor pentatonic scale descending at any speed that you want, like this. That'll do. You can pick it, you can play pull-offs. You can play it like this. Make sense? Now what I want you to do is play it again, but I just want you to listen to the sound of the scale. Just focus on the sound. Focus on how cool every note sounds. Focus on your lovely tone that you've got dialed up, or the sound of your guitar unplugged. Let's just try that real quick. So A minor pentatonic descending. Just listen to the sound. Don't think too much about what's going on with your hands. Just focus on the sound. Here we go. Interesting. Now, let's do the same experiment, but this time what I want you to do is I want you to play exactly the same thing, but I want you to physically concentrate on placing each finger and striking the string with your pick. So physically control every movement that you make. Really get in touch with what's going on in your hands and physically move every piece involved in playing this scale. Let's try it. Wow, that is difficult. That's not the easiest thing to do. Let me know if, like me, you found that weirdly uncoordinated, even though you were kind of exerting more conscious control of your playing. Like, let me know if that's something that happened to you. It definitely happened to me. I found it weirdly, weirdly challenging. So here's what's going on here. Have you ever had that thing where you're playing away and you realize that you're not actually concentrating on every note? You realize that you're just kind of like letting the notes take care of themselves. It might be something like this, for example. I'm going to go back to the Seattle thing, because it's a cool track and I'm into it. So let's do that again. Backing track's a little loud for the vocals, according to Scott. That is totally fine. I will just knock that down a little bit. So if I'm playing away, see, there I tried to exert control and it fell apart. I'm not going to pay any attention to what I'm playing. I'm just going to play. That is probably one of the cleanest bits of legato I've played all night, I think. And you could even hear, if you were to listen back, I could hear it when I tuned in and went, oh, you better take control of this. That's not how any of this works. And oftentimes, when we try to take this conscious control of our playing, because either we're disappointed with how we sound, or somebody has come into the room, or you find yourself in a performance situation, maybe you're on a live stream, who knows, it just kind of messes things up, right? So I've had this thing with my playing for the longest time, and I always felt guilty about it because I felt as though this was something that I was doing and I shouldn't be doing. So I had this thing where I wouldn't really concentrate at all on what I was playing, and I would just listen to what came out. I'd let the chips fall where they may. I'd almost like be almost like an audience member to my own playing. Turns out that a huge proportion of really great musicians do exactly this. They do exactly this. They are impassive observers of their own playing. Sports people do this as well, by the way, which is where The Inner Game of Tennis comes in. Really, really valuable book. So if you haven't read it already, do so. So listen, that has been a whole rant on where tension comes from, why tension appears, all that sort of thing. We are going to extend the Q&A this week because we've got loads and loads of great questions. Normally we reserve it for 15 minutes. We're going to do a 20-minute Q&A this time around. So I'm going to give you guys 1 minute to get your last few questions in. Drop your questions. Drop your questions down there in the comments. I'm going to play a little bit longer, and then we are going to delve in with some questions here because there are so many great questions already. Let's do that. I'm going to play. I'm going to knock that backing track back up, and let's go. I'm enjoying this track, so I'll probably play it a little bit more, I think. In fact, no, let's go back to the original one because the original one was really fun. This is the Cinematic Rock Ballad in A minor. So let's do it. Let's do that. Drop your questions in the comments. We'll do the Q&A 1 minute's time. Here we go. That's quite enough of that. Let's go to the Q&A. All right, so let's get stuck in with some of your questions. We've had some of the great ones have come in the little interval that we did there. If you're just joining us, by the way, thanks for coming on board. This is a discussion on tension and how it affects your playing. Are you using too much? Are you using too little? When is it good? When is it bad? All of that sort of stuff. Also, if you are just joining us, consider giving us a thumbs up, drop a like, drop us a comment, share this with your guitar playing friends, all that sort of stuff. If you've missed the beginning, that's okay. You can check this stream out on the replay on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. And of course, the best way to support us is by checking out GI Plus, where you'll find loads of lessons that support these streams and go way, way, way into more depth than we could possibly do here. So we are going to wind our way way back up to the top of the comment section. And I'm going to start with Sacred Godslayer. So, very interested in this lesson because I suffer from chronic muscular inflammation. So it's mandatory for me to have least tension as possible. Now this is this ties a little bit to playing and pain and injury, which is a subject that I know about that much about. But luckily, I've got some great resources available for. It's mainly from the lifting side of things regarding pain and injury. Specifically, the science-based community, Barbell Medicine, have some of the best information about this if you're interested in some stuff that does carry over into guitar playing. But let's get into some advice for this. I think that is, first of all, I'm really sorry to hear that, but it doesn't mean that you necessarily have to suffer as a guitar player. There are some steps you can take to play with as little tension as possible. One of them is to consider using a lighter string gauge, if you can get away with it. Consider using a lighter pick as well. Heavy picks don't always equal better tone. There is an amount of pick that's going to allow you to play lightly on the string. It might not be as thick as you think it is. So consider doing that. Monitor your pick and touch is a way to do it. So if you want to reduce your tension, as a rule of thumb, keep an eye on your pick and hand. Make sure it's not gripping crazy, crazy hard. A few things with that. So we'll get onto that perhaps in more detail another time, but hopefully that's going to be at least slightly useful for you, my man. Again, you know, not going to stop you being a great guitar player. I see no reason why it should. Just got to keep an eye on that that picking technique. So, Marcin says, when I pick harder, my left hand tension increases. Any ideas how to solve this? Yes. Yes, indeed. Here's how we're going to fix this, Marcin. You are going to perform an exercise that is something like this. We are going to play a chromatic figure. It can be any figure you want. Maybe like this. And then we're going to start moving one finger at a time to the next string to give us this. And maybe like this. And maybe like this. Now the exercise itself is immaterial. Any exercise will do, provided you're moving from one string to another, because that is going to be one of the leading indicators of how much tension you have in your playing. Now, you are going to take... do I have one handy? I'm going to grab one. There's one way over here. There's a good look down my shirt. There's nothing interesting down there, I promise. Just some hair. As you can see, you can take one of these. For those of you looking at home, this is a four-sided dice. Hey. We talked in a previous stream about using dice in your practice. You're going to roll the four-sided dice. I pulled up a four. Let's run with that. Every time I play finger number four, I'm going to accent it. And by accent, I mean pick hard. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to play like this. That's hard to do. This one. This on its own will require a level of control that is not possible with a ton of tension. Even just doing this exercise is going to help. So randomize which finger you're accenting, accent that finger. You can also do it in an improvisation context, but that requires a little more concentration. So that's a good exercise to play with that. Hopefully that is going to give you some use. Ryan Just says, does pickup output come into play here? Yeah, it kind of does. I guess we're referring to the getting a clean, loud note, especially with hammer-ons. Now, you can play with a guitar sound that is, let's say, excessively dynamic. I've got a DI set up here, so what I'm going to do, Hopefully you guys will be able to hear this. I'm really not sure. I'll have to remember to turn this off at the end as well. So let's try. There's my amp sound. I'm going to mute the amp and I'm going to turn my DI on. Let me know if you guys can hear this. That's literally a DI directly from my guitar. Not the most pleasant sound, I'm sure you'll agree. I couldn't even hear it, to be fair. It's not even turned on in my mix. It's just turned on in the mix coming to where you guys are. Now, that is as dynamic as a guitar sound is ever going to get, because there is nothing providing compression at all. Full stop. So if I play with a clean sound, I don't even have my compressor switched on. This is just a clean amp sound. The dynamic range is nowhere near what it was with the in terms of like loud to soft, nowhere near what it was in terms of the DI sound. So having an amp sound that is at least a little bit compressed, which is most amps, by the way. Even if you play a clean amp, most of them are compressed, unless it's the cleanest of clean, clean, clean sounds, which is never that fun to play. It always feels a little bit stiff. It does help iron things out. Now, your pickup output is going to determine how compressed that amp gets. So if I use my split coil, which is going to lower the output of my pickup. So this is the full fat humbucker. Here's the split coil. And I play like this. There's the split coil. Here's the humbucker. The humbucker is going to help me produce loud notes with less effort because there's a little bit more sound. A little bit more sound coming out with the guitar. When I go up to the split coil, I do have to pick a little bit harder to be consistent. With hammer-ons, it's still not necessarily the case because the sound from a hammer-on doesn't come from how hard you press, but how, I guess, how rapidly and sharply you strike when you hit the string. So we talked about hammer-ons before being more of a strike than a press. So what I mean by that is it's not so much that we're pressing the string, that doesn't really make a hammer-on happen. It's that we're forcefully striking the string so that the string impacts the fret above. It's actually the sound of the string striking the fret that produces the hammer-on, not the finger. The finger doesn't really have a whole lot to do with it. The finger is just bringing the string into contact with the fret quickly, and that's where the hammer-on comes from. So pickup output does have a place. Very, very cool question. Also, your pickups, if they're too hot, can dampen the dynamic range, which can lead to you putting more tension in than you necessarily would want to in the pursuit dynamics that just aren't there. Really good question. Now, on this subject, Ryan had a fantastic question about thumb placement. So we're going to go back to this. Ryan's question regarding thumb placement. What is proper thumb placement? Some say never place your thumb over the guitar neck unless doing a bend. Proper thumb placement is wherever it feels comfortable. There is no proper thumb placement in electric guitar. There is no proper, because there is no one universal technique when it comes to electric guitar. A lot of advice regarding thumb placement and regarding things like this come from classical guitar, which is inherently a much more physically challenging instrument to play than the electric guitar. Classical guitars, if you ever tried to play them, you have to use all of the strength that you have. You have to move heaven and friggin' earth just to fret a note, unless you have an electric guitar that's set up extremely poorly, or you happen to be playing one of Stevie Ray Vaughan's guitars. I would argue that's the same thing. Not set up poorly for him, but set up poorly for mortals like myself. You don't need that kind of extra pressure. Now, as far as your thumb's role when it comes to playing the guitar, we talked about this at length, but your thumb is not there to exert tension, to exert pressure on the guitar's neck. It exists in this context only to give you a cue as to where your fingers are in relation to the fretboard. So your thumb should touch, but not press. And wherever you decide to put that is totally fine. We can find players with outrageously great bending and vibrato technique that have a tucked thumb, like Doug Aldrich, for example. We can find shredders, crazy, crazy chops monsters, that have a thumb over position, like Paul Gilbert, for example. There is no hard and fast rule, and for every rule that says you must do this, you will be able to find dozens of players that are exceptions to this rule. So there's no one place to put it, but I would say that you should think about your thumb being a touch rather than a press. It's really there as a proprioceptive cue rather than a device to help you exert force into the guitar? Very interesting, though. Very, very interesting question. Two great questions from my man there. So let's keep cracking. We've got some other fabulous questions coming on a little further down. So let's dig into those. Simon Croft says, shawl attention is terrible also. Suggestions, please. Okay, so shawl attention is an interesting one because if your shoulder is tense, it's way up here by your neck like that. Like so, it's very, very difficult to maintain a loose and relaxed right hand. A few things to do with this. The most obvious and easiest one, it's just going to sound like so redundant, but just relax your shoulder. Like focus hard on relaxing the shoulder while you play. A big strap can help with this. You'll notice I have this like really wide four rows of grommets kind of strap. Helps distribute the weight of the guitar across my shoulders, so I don't necessarily feel the weight of the guitar, which means this hand is not burdened by the load. This guitar's not very heavy anyway. And you know, my hobby is picking up and putting down heavy objects for fun. So let's tell you everything you need to know about me. I don't really buy into this idea of, oh my God, my Les Paul weighs 10 pounds. It's so heavy. I'm like, 10 pounds, bro. But I'm a meathead, so you can feel free to ignore me on that count. But a wide strap helps distribute some weight. I would also consider sitting in a way where you're fairly neutral. So I don't think this playing position is terribly comfortable for any extended period of time. I sit like this for a few reasons. First of all, it's much easier to frame a guitar like this on video. So I play like this for you guys. But also it's a little closer to the way I play standing up. And I find it helps me, just look at my body posture here, when I'm sitting like this, I find it helps me keep my shoulders kind of at least roughly in a fairly neutral range of motion. There's nothing harmful about playing like this. It can just be a little tiring if you have to keep your shoulder up there for any length of time. So that's a thought, Simon. Shoulder tiring out can be shoulder tension as well. So if you find yourself in a position where you're like, oh, dude, like I'm way up here, that can cause you problems, especially if you're like, you need to be there to actually physically play the guitar. So maybe how you're holding the guitar might be something to do with it. Really good question though. Really, really good question. Here we go. Joe Johnson UK says, any advice for turning shreddy nonsense into melodic solos? For sure. The best advice I can give you is take responsibility for the phrases you play. Now, this is in direct contravention to the advice I said a little while ago, which is don't micromanage your technique. That's not what I'm talking about. Micromanaging your technique is one thing. We don't want to do that. But we do want to pay attention to the notes we're playing. And we want to essentially sing through our guitar. So when you're playing stuff, you want to be quite intentional about, for example, I don't know, if I'm playing a phrase. I realized that was several phrases, but even still, if I'm playing something, I want to hear that as a stream of notes that appear in my head and appear on the guitar at the same time. This doesn't mean that you have to anticipate everything that you're playing. It just means that you have to mentally sing along with what you're playing while you're playing it, if that makes sense. I think that's what's going through players' heads when they do the sing and play trick, like the George Benson thing, or when Steve Vai does it in harmony because he's clever shit and loves to do stuff like that. I do love me some Steve Vai, by the way. So taking responsibility for that can be a big thing, but here's a thing that can make it a little less daunting, is taking responsibility for the tone and the dynamics, if that makes sense, the tone and the dynamics of what you're playing. So just listening to the sound of notes and focusing in on that is going to give you more control of your phrases, but also more control over the execution too, because we did that experiment before where focusing on the sound of what you're playing helped us relax into our playing as well. So that's something to focus on. Beyond that, just practice, man. You can set yourself, and that's really redundant, but you can set yourself some practice goals, like maybe throwing on a backing track and saying, I am only going to play phrases that contain eighth notes or less. So, you know, nothing more than eighth notes. So it might be like this. Maybe like that kind of bass. There's an eighth note. I'm on mute. Practice. I've talked about this before. Very, very good way to develop this sort of stuff. So, great question, my man. Very, very happy we can answer it. Hopefully, that is something that's of use to you. So, let's get into this as well. Here we go. Blue Sumlin says, it's like a bad day at the office. Feel stressed or tense. I don't pick up the guitar. Yes, 100%. There is something to be said for observing the effects of life stress. So job, school, family, whatever, you know, bad day on the roads, let's say, so, you know, some guy cuts you off. All of these have an effect on your acute ability to perform. And if you're having a bad day, you might not be able to perform at your absolute apex in terms of control. Maybe you didn't sleep. You know, maybe you have a young baby who keeps waking you up in the middle of the night or whatever. Stress can affect the way you play hugely in ways that, you know, we can't possibly begin to comprehend. With this stuff, it's important to kind of recognize that and recognize that stress can impact your guitar playing. And then when you pick up the guitar, your expectations for what you're going to play can be unreasonable for where you are on a given day. So what I would suggest for things like that is if you feel like picking up the guitar, pick the guitar up, man. Lower your expectations. Say, I'm not going to play anything crazy today. I'm a little stressed out. I'm just going to play and I'm going to enjoy the fact that, you know, I live in a world where I'm able to come to a warm home and play some guitar, because that's pretty great. I'm not suggesting for a moment that you're anything other than grateful for this stuff. That's not what I'm saying. But the point with this is reframe your expectations for how you're going to play when you've had a bad day. Cut yourself some slack, man. Like, don't expect to, you know, write the next Stairway to Heaven guitar solo when you've had a bad old day at the office. It happens. Play for the joy of it. Allow yourself to be below where you'd expect to be in terms of your performance. Give yourself a break. What I'm trying to say. More questions. Here we go. A really great question from Paul. I have way too much tension, but some of mine comes from trying to clamp down because of lift-off string noises. I have 9-year-old length fingers as well. Well, hey man, some 9-year-olds got huge fingers, and I know at least one 40-something-year-old who has tiny little fingers as well. Didn't stop him, let me tell you. So anyway, finger length is one thing. When it comes to you clamping down because of string noise, dude, I wholeheartedly relate. A few things with this. I would say that, first of all, the guitar does make noise. And when you're playing in context, string noise is nowhere near as bad as you think it is. When you listen to it in isolation, listen to some isolated guitar parts. Somebody mentioned Steve Lukather before. Listen to some isolated Steve Lukather guitar parts, you'll hear lots of string noise, let me tell you, and it's fine. You know, dude's one of the greatest guitar players of our time. Nothing wrong with a bit of string noise. A bit of noise is okay. If there's no noise, how will they know you're dangerous? But the other thing with this is string noise doesn't necessarily come from... it's often the product of trying too hard. Sounds kind of counterintuitive, but if you are super tense, it's very, very difficult to bring your fingers off the string in such a way that it doesn't create noise. I guess another thing as well is to address the causes of noise. We talked about the idea of hammering on too hard, creating noise. So let's go to a slightly dirty sound. I'll show you what I mean. It's this, right? Gentle hammer-ons. Not touching any of the strings. Loads more noise, purely because of the fact that I'm basically doing this. So tension can actually cause noise by putting too much force into the guitar anyway. I do this. And then I play with loads of tension. Where's all that extra noise come from? I didn't even touch those strings. Well, didn't matter, because by banging on the guitar from this direction has the same sound as banging on the guitar from this direction. Really, really cool observation, my man. Really into that. Thank you very much for your question. Really appreciate it. So, let's go on to another point here from Roy Lisbon. This is really interesting here. Roy Lisbon says, this requires removing your focus away from thinking what you're playing. Stress, performance, anxiety, it's acquired from muscle memory and time, I believe. Yeah, dude, an absolutely great observation. And also trusting in that muscle memory, reminding yourself that you've put the hours in. You have put the hours in. This is something you're capable of. You can do this. You have this. This is something that is well within your capability. And if you make a mistake, it doesn't matter. Everyone makes mistakes. It's not the end of the world. This is why I'm a big believer in leaving mistakes. It's why we do this live. It's why I don't just pre-record the performances and then edit them for Instagram. Did I say Instagram? Shouldn't have said Instagram. It's TikTok. No, I'm joking. We don't do any of that silly nonsense. Because, like, it just sets up expectations for you guys that you should be perfect, and nobody's perfect. It's just not the case. Another really cool thing here from Roy says, if you have great tone and sufficient volume when practicing, I find it can reduce finger tension. 100%. Great tone really does help. Finding a tone that you like, man, it makes a difference. It really does make a difference. One more question. Let's go way down to the bottom here. Let's see. Ah, interesting. Here we go. Great stream. Thank you. I bet you I bet you I will have questions. When playing, is there a place to join on the website to ask them? For sure. Dude, come back here next week and ask again. Do you know, like, I'm always happy to answer your questions. They don't have to be about this week's stream. You can ask anything you want on the streams. Also, you can message us on Instagram, right? Follow us on Instagram, Guitar Interactive Magazine, at Guitar Interactive Magazine. Send us a message. Always happy to talk, right? And if you want to send us a video, hey, that would be great too. Here we go. Last question. Tom Holland. Is it the same Tom Holland? Is this the Tom Holland that I know? Hey, Nick, you ever had any problems with RSI? Yeah, for sure, man. Had in both hands. Repetitive strain in both hands. I am of the opinion that repetitive strain comes from doing more than you're prepared to do, let's say, for an extended period of time. You're outstripping the practice or playing capabilities that you have. I don't mean playing stuff that you can't play. I mean playing like 10 minutes a day for a year and then deciding I'm going to practice 6 hours a day. Yeah, that's a great way to get RSI. However, if you're adapted to playing 6 hours a day, it's not going to be a problem. Right, humans adapt to things. It's the way we work. I'm also pleased to say it went away. No magical remedies. Tried all the things. Tried bananas and Gatorade and lighter strain gauges. Actually, lighter strain gauges did help. They did help. And they helped me to transition back into a more normal strain gauge. So yeah, absolutely do. Live play guitar. Hi Nick, when I'm picking, my pick hand has a mind of its own, travels towards the bridge, retraining my brain to stay picking nearer the neck. It's just something to experiment with, my man. I have a picking course that we're going to be filming at the end of this month as well, so that's coming too. But that's something else. So anyway, listen, Billy is Fat Bob. I'm mostly always tense due to life and disappointing guitar playing. Man, hey, if there's not a relatable comment to finish on, I don't know what it is. Guys, thank you so much for having me. I've done an extra long Q&A and we've still gone over time. So listen, I'm going to leave you with some noodling. But also, if you haven't done so already, here's a few things you can do to help us out. You can check the stream out in the replay. You can check out all the other streams on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. You can share them with your guitar playing friends, either on social media or just, you know, you can just tell people about them. Say, hey, tune in to these live streams. They're at 8 p.m. UK time every Monday, which they are. That is true. You can give us a thumbs up. You can give us a comment, which you guys have done so already. I just love the community we have going on here. It's the highlight of my week. I think I say this every week, but it legitimately is. I love doing these streams with you guys. bananas and Gatorade. If you know, you know. Ah, for sure. 100%. So, thanks for joining us. Support us by doing all of those things. Also, you can check out GI Plus, where you will get just lessons upon lessons upon lessons on every subject imaginable. Tom Quayle, is a master on this stuff, and we've loads of lessons from Tom. So hey, go check out some of Tom's lessons. GI Plus, in the meantime, let's noodle. I will see you guys next week, same time, same place. Give us a subscribe, turn that bell icon on so we can let you know when we're going live. Subscribe to our email mailing list if you want to be reminded of these streams and hear about special offers and news and all that sort of stuff. Links will be below. My name is Nick Jennison. I'll see you next week. Same track. Let's do it. Lights has gone off. See you next week. My name is Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters? Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.